The Americas have a unique history among the various continents of the world. Virtually every country and territory in these two continents have been heavily shaped and influenced by the successive waves of immigration that have originated from almost every region of the planet. The three cultures that had the largest historical impact on the United States were the Europeans, Sub-Saharan Africans, and of course, the indigenous inhabitants of North America. The situation regarding racial identity in the modern-day United States is obviously more complicated than merely white and black. It was also much more than that in America's past. There are countless groups that didn't fall under the category of black, white, or Native American, and their descendants are still around and kicking to this day. And even though many of them still hold on to their historic ethnic and cultural identities, it's extremely difficult to find a comprehensive and concise analysis of their populations and that of contemporary America. Most people are aware of the historical fact that in the early United States, if a slave-owning male had a child with a female slave, the child was automatically born into slavery. But if a black male slave had a child with a woman that was not a slave, regardless of race, the child would automatically be born free. This is how the majority of different communities of free people of color were created, through black slaves having children with non-slave women, or by slave owners freeing their slaves. Even though they were a small minority of the black American population, free people of color had a unique history and culture that has contributed to many of the mixed-race ethnic groups that we're going to discuss in this video. One of the states that had the highest number and proportion of free people of color was the state of Virginia, especially near the western portion of the state, where freed or escaped slaves would often flee to Native American tribal land and intermingle with the Amerindians. It's believed that the people group known as the Mulungians are at least partially descended from a splinter group of these Virginian free people of color who were either escaped slaves or born to free women of European or African stock and fled westwards towards the border with Tennessee sometime around the late 1700s to early 1800s. These free people of color frequently mixed with the sundry of Native American groups in the region, and rather than just assimilating into the host Amerindian tribe or into the larger Black American population as a whole, this group of mixed-race people began to form their own communities and identity. Now, new ethnic groups are created when a group splinters and develops separately from the host ethnicity, or in some cases, ethnicities, and usually slowly develop their own language, culture, and identity. In the case of many of these mixed-race ethnicities in the early United States, they created their own ethnic identity and subculture, but had not yet formed their own dialect or language, speaking English similar to that of the inhabitants of the surrounding regions. As more settlers of European origin began to arrive in the Appalachian region, the group that would later be known as the Mulungians also began to fraternize with these settlers of mostly English and Celtic origin. This resulted in a population that was of Amerindian, African, and European DNA, and they didn't really fit into groups of other free people of color, Southern whites, or the increasingly scant group of Native Americans, and thus began marrying into their own ethnic group, a process known as endogamy. Rather than being a result of a founder population, or a population that has descended from a relatively small group of related people and then fanning outwards, the Mulungians were descended from many divergent groups of people who mostly associated with each other out of convenience and necessity, and as such, no two members of the ethnic group would have exactly the same genetic makeup, and phenotype for various individuals varied greatly. The Mulungian people were largely endogamous until the 1900s when the group started to marry into the surrounding white American people. Many of the Mulungians were hence assimilated into white America as each progressive generation became whiter, and many concealed any and all non-European heritage since it was seen as a disadvantage in the Jim Crow era South, and to be fair, at the time it would have been. However, there was a large chunk of the Mulungian population that kept their ethnic identity and have embraced their heritage to the present day. Because many Mulungians had married into the white population, their genetic makeup is far more European than African or Amerindian, and many can in fact pass for full-blooded Europeans. And as such, in the modern American census, nearly all members of the Mulungians will identify as white American, although a significant minority identify as black, Native American, mixed race, or some other race. Because of these discrepancies, it's nearly impossible to find accurate sources on just how many of the Mulungian descendants are still around to this day and what exactly their average genetic makeup is. I've done a lot of research and speculation on the group in the same way that I looked into the Louisiana Creole people, and by looking at census records in the Appalachian region and extrapolating to the current year, there are probably somewhere from 50 to 150,000 people that actively identify as Mulungian in the states of Tennessee, Kentucky, and Virginia. By poring through countless genetic studies on the modern Mulungian people, it appears the average racial makeup of the collective is about 70.3% European, 15.7% African, 8.5% Native American, 3.4% Middle Eastern, 1.1% Jewish, and 1% Roma or Gypsy. However, in the past, before integration with the whites, the percentage of African and Amerindian DNA was probably much higher. The Redbones are another multiracial group of Native American, European, and African mix that inhabit the border region between the states of Texas and Louisiana. Even less is known about the history and origin of the Redbones than the Mulungians, but from what we can tell, the Redbones are most likely descended from an early group of Mulungians who settled in the neutral zone between what was then the American state of Louisiana and the state of Coahuila and Tejas in Mexico. As more European and American migrants from the southern United States began to settle in Mexican Texas, they frequently clashed with the Redbones of eastern Texas and southwest Louisiana, culminating in the Regulator-Moderator War in the 1840s, which wasn't necessarily fought exclusively over the Redbones, but greatly involved their group. Very few people actively identify as an ethnic Redbone to this day because of assimilation and others attempting to obscure their multiracial background, but by my estimates, there are probably around 20 to 40,000 Redbones that are aware of their ethnicity. Similar to the Mulungians of Appalachia, nearly all Redbones identify as white in the U.S. Census. The western portion of the United States has by far the largest number and percentage of multiracial or people of mixed origin in the country, and not just from recent interracial marriages, which are at an all-time high. The majority of immigrants from Hispanic and Latino countries to the U.S. are what can be classified as mestizos, that being a mix of early Spanish settlers to Latin America and the various Native American tribes. They are, without a doubt, the largest group of mixed-race people in the United States in the present day, and they deserve their own independent video to elaborate on their unique history and genetics. The West Coast has some very remarkable people from mixed-race ethnic groups that most Americans have never heard of. These include groups like the Punjabi Mexican Americans, a mouthful I know, and unfortunately there's no other name for this group of people, but they have a very noteworthy origin. As their name would imply, they're descendants from Indian Punjabis and Mexican farmers who settled in the northern Californian city of Yuba in the early 1900s. The Punjabis were overwhelmingly Sikh in their religion and spoke Punjabi at home, with maybe slightly below conversational levels of English and Spanish, while virtually all of the Mexican women they married were Roman Catholics and spoke almost no English. This led to a rather quirky situation where the children of these unions spoke Punjabi, Spanish, and English, and in some cases practiced both Sikhism and Catholicism. Their descendants are still around today, but number perhaps only in the low thousands, as the majority of them were either absorbed into the growing Indian or Mexican communities in Northern California. Additionally, a huge chunk of the U.S. state of Hawaii's population is mixed race at around 23%, making it the highest percentage of any state if you don't count mestizos as being mixed race, which they are, of course, but the U.S. Census counts them under some other race rather than multiracial, which is odd. However, the majority of the over 400,000 mixed race people in Hawaii are mostly unrelated incidences of parents of different races, rather than being a part of an established ethnic group that is of multiracial origin, such as the previously mentioned Mulungians or Redbones. The most common mix for multiracial Hawaiians would be Pacific Islanders, mostly Polynesians, and East Asians, mostly Japanese, followed by people of European and Polynesian ancestry and European and Asian ancestry. There's also a large community of people with both European, Polynesian, and East Asian heritage, a rarity in the United States. There really is so much more I would want to talk about when it comes to this topic. For those of you who don't know, my mom is part Iranian and Black American, And my dad is part German, Irish, Dutch. And if you were wondering, I don't really feel any personal connection with other multiracial Americans, but I do find it quite interesting to learn about the history of multiracial ethnic groups. So go ahead and let me know in the comments section below what ethnic groups in the modern world you think have the most fascinating history, and what you... Actually, that could get a little ugly. Just be kind, be cool. Thanks for watching, everyone. And I know it's a little late, but happy Independence Day. This has been Mason, and I'll see you in the next one.